Before the era of LEDs, we relied on fragile glass bulbs with glowing filaments, bulky, hot, and energy hungry. Today, tiny semiconductor chips cast light with incredible efficiency. Have you ever wondered how light-emitting diodes can light up your world, from the tiniest indicator to stadium-sized video walls? On Engineeringness, we're diving into everything you need to know about light-emitting diodes, also known as LEDs. What is an LED? A light-emitting diode, or LED, is a tiny two-terminal semiconductor device that lights up whenever you push current through it. But unlike a simple resistor or incandescent bulb, an LED only starts conducting and only starts glowing once you apply a voltage above its forward voltage threshold. This is because the tiny semiconductor material within an LED emits energy as photons when the forward voltage threshold is exceeded. As with diodes, LEDs work on the same principle, as you can see by the similar symbols. The LED symbol has two arrows indicating that light is being emitted. The anode, A, is the positive terminal where current flows in. The cathode, K, is the negative terminal where current flows out. Unlike standard diodes, LEDs emit photons, and for visible LEDs, that's typically in the circa 380 to 740 nanometer band. If you're enjoying this deep dive into the world of electronic components, don't forget to subscribe to Engineeringness and give us a thumbs up. We've got plenty more tech explorations to come. Check out our online store for unique engineering products and help us keep making awesome content. It really helps us out a lot. Link down below. Another way to support Engineeringness is by becoming a member. This will give you early access to all our videos, access to our member-only videos, which show how we animate and put videos together, as well as enabling our member-only chat rooms, where we can discuss all things Engineeringness. How do LEDs work? LEDs work on the same principles as semiconductors. To learn more about semiconductors, check out our previous semiconductor video. At its core, an LED is a PN junction, two regions of a direct bandgap semiconductor doped with different impurities. The P side contains holes, positive charge carriers, and is located on the anode side of the LED. The N side contains free electrons, negative charge carriers, that are located on the cathode side of the LED. When the PN junction is formed, electrons and holes recombine near the interface, creating a depletion region devoid of free charge. This region acts as a barrier, preventing charge flow until the applied voltage overcomes it. This explains why LEDs can only emit light once their voltage threshold is exceeded. If we connect a battery and show the electron flow through a PN junction, we can see the forward bias in action. Once you forward bias that PN junction, electrons race across and reunite with holes in the active region, releasing their extra energy as photons of light. That, my friends, is electroluminescence in action. The science behind LEDs. To understand how exactly a photon is emitted from the semiconductor within an LED, let's first take a look at an atom and its makeup. We have your standard nucleus containing protons and neutrons, surrounded by shells containing electrons. Each shell can only contain a certain amount of electrons. This is due to something known as the Pauli exclusion principle. And each electron has to have a certain amount of energy to be accepted into the shell. The further the distance of the shell from the nucleus, the more energy is required from the electron to move into that shell, and the more energy the electrons within that shell have. This is because the farther away from the nucleus an electron is, the less effect the opposite charge from the nucleus, which is positive, has on the electron, ergo increasing its electrostatic potential energy. Electrons closer to the nucleus also shield the outer electrons from some of the effects of the nucleus. This is explained via Coulomb's law. Back to our shells, the outermost shell is known as the valence shell, and outside of this, the conduction band. Under forward bias, when connected to a battery, for example, electrons in the N region's conduction band are injected across the junction into the P region's conduction band. To to recombine with holes in the p-side valence band, they must lose energy equal to the semiconductor's band gap. In direct band gap materials, this energy is released as a photon, electroluminescence. In indirect band gap materials, it is typically lost non-radiatively as heat. How do LEDs work in a circuit? If we connect a diode into an LED circuit in the correct orientation, the LED will emit light, as the diode will allow flow through it in only one direction. This is also known as the forward bias, allowing current to flow through it and the diode itself to act as a conductor. This is because the electric field at the junction weakens, the depletion barrier collapses, and charges surge through effortlessly conducting current. But if we flip this diode within the circuit, then the diode will act as an insulator, and this is known as reverse bias. The junction's barrier grows stronger, blocking the flow. Only a trickle of leakage current can sneak through the widened depletion zone. The anatomy of an LED. At the very base, we have the substrate, often sapphire or silicon carbide. This rigid platform supports everything above it. Grown directly on the substrate are the epitaxial layers. First, the N-type layer, the source of our free electrons or charge carriers, then the P-type layer, full of holes where electrons can go. These crystalline layers are meticulously deposited atom by atom to form the semiconductor junction. Sandwiched between them is the active region, a wafer-thin zone. When we apply forward bias, electrons flow from the N side into this region and recombine with holes from the P-type side. Each recombination event releases energy as a photon, light. To feed that flow of electrons, we attach metal contacts on both sides of the junction. A tiny wire bond connects the top contact to the external lead frame, while the bottom contact is often part of the base itself. These metal pathways ensure current reaches the active region with minimal resistance. Encasing the entire chip is the encapsulating dome, a colored or clear epoxy lens depending on its use. It does two jobs, protecting the fragile semiconductor from dust and moisture and shaping the light beam into the focused glow we see. In high-power white LEDs, there's one more layer, the phosphor coating. A thin film of phosphor sits just under the dome, absorbing the native blue light and re-emitting it as broad spectrum white. That's how your phone's flashlight or a room brightening LED achieves its warm, balanced glow. Color and band gap engineering. Have you ever noticed the different colors of LEDs and wondered why is a red LED different from a green LED? It all comes down to band gap energy, the energy difference between semiconductor bands. By tweaking the semiconductor alloy, for example, gallium arsenide, gallium phosphide, or indium gallium nitride as just a few examples, manufacturers can span the full visible spectrum and even into infrared and ultraviolet. The types of LED and their uses. Here is a table highlighting the different types of LEDs, their usual colors, and the typical use cases. Indicator LED, red, green, yellow, power or status indicators. High power LED, white, RGB, lighting, flashlights, stage lighting. SMD LED, various, TV, backlight panels, phone displays. Infrared LED, around 850 nanometers. Remote controls, night vision illuminators. Ultraviolet LED, 365 to 405 nanometer. Curing, sterilization, counterfeit detections. Next time you flip on a light switch or glance at your phone's notification LED, remember the marvel of semiconductor physics at work. Those tiny chips are lighting up our homes, guiding our cars, and dazzling our screens efficiently and reliably. Thanks for watching. If you found this video helpful, be sure to like, share, and subscribe to Engineeringness. Stay curious and never stop exploring the incredible world of science and engineering.